Malta may be a small island in the middle of the Mediterranean, but it can boast more than 7,000 years of history, and in that time has been ruled over by 10 different powers. Getting to grips with all that information in the short break that we've got there is going to be no easy task. But to help orientate us, they have a very useful land train which will take us right round Valletta. The train starts its journey from outside St John's Cathedral and soon crosses one of the main streets in Valletta, Republica, before descending sharply down the steep streets to the harbour. Even though it's still early March, the sun is warm and clearly the tourists are enjoying themselves in the Café Society of Malta. One of the more unusual ships to have weighed anchor here is the Black Pearl, built in Sweden in 1909. It was abandoned here after catching fire in the Suez Canal. It was formerly owned by Errol Flynn.
Late in the 15th century, when the island was under Harkonnen's domination, a modest fort was built.
As far back as the 14th century, there was a small chapel here dedicated to St. Elmo, who was the patron saint of seafarers. But the Knights of St. John extended the fortifications in 1552 in an attempt to keep out the Turks. That failed. Despite the continued building works over the centuries, several other invaders managed to avoid its fortifications. But the British made very good use of it in World War II, and this period in the fort's history is a central feature of the National War Museum, which we'll see later on our tour.
Now see the Siege Bell War Memorial. This memorial commemorates the victory of the Allied forces during the Siege of Malta from 1940 to 1943. Almost 1,500 civilians died during the Second Siege of Malta. The monument was designed by the British sculptor Michael Sandel.
Once the tour turns inland, you soon realise why this is called the Grand Harbour. The tour gave a first look at the three cities, the origins of which predate Valletta by some way. The fortification on the opposite side of the harbour is Fort St. Angelo, which, as we were to learn later, has played an enormous part in the history of Malta throughout its existence. Valletta grew in prominence after the great siege of 1565 was defeated, and the capital was moved here from Mdina.
Now on your left-hand side, you can now see the Phoenicia Hotel. This beautiful hotel was constructed in the 1930s. It was designed in the style of Art Deco and is still regarded today as one of the top five hotels in Malta.
There have been fortifications on this site for many centuries, but the star-shaped fort of Fort Elmo was begun in 1552. Although the Ottoman Great Siege finally defeated the fort, they held out for 28 days. Its history since then has been one of constant change and improvement. Like a great many buildings in Valletta, the fort was badly damaged in World War II. Much of that restoration work still continues today. And this is shown to good effect in the Piazza d'Armi, which is due for an official opening shortly after our visit. Over the centuries, as the fortifications were strengthened, the building went higher and higher. And this view will give you a really good illustration of just what a strategic position it's in. The National War Museum houses a wonderful collection of items, taking the visitor back as far as prehistoric times. The emphasis of this part of the exhibition was on the Knights of St. John, who arrived in Malta in 1530. Their rule was brought to an end by Napoleon. However, the French tenure was short-lived when the Maltese rebelled, aided by Admiral Lord Nelson. And thus began more than 100 years of British rule, which finally ended in 1964. The two following calls concentrate on the role of Malta in World Wars I and II. In the early part of World War II, the air defence of the island was provided by three ancient-looking Gloucester gladiators, Faith, Hope and Charity. And this is all that remains of Faith. The second great siege of Malta, which took place between 1940-42, was predominantly a sustained aerial bombardment of huge proportions. There were more than 3,300 raids, 15,000 tons of bombs were dropped, and 1,500 civilians and 7,500 military became casualties in that time. Amid the destruction, there were many stories of courage and bravery, none more so than the story of the SS Ohio. The ship was a brand new and fast tanker, along with 14 other merchant ships and 56 naval vessels, set sail for Malta in August 42. Only five of the merchant ships actually made it through to Valetta, including the Ohio, which despite its back being broken by enemy torpedoes, managed to deliver its cargo, although it subsequently sank. The co-cathedral was started in 1573 by the French Grand Master of the Order, who decorated the church lavishly. Ironically, most of it was removed in 1798 when Napoleon invaded with the French army. Some, but not all, was recovered later, but what remains is certainly very impressive. The co-reference means it has a shared function with another. In the case of Malta, it's the St. Paul's Cathedral on Mdina, which we'll see later in our visit. Between Valletta and Sliema is Marsanset Harbour. After a very nice lunch in M&S, but of course only because it has the best view of Valletta, we set forth on a boat cruise heading for the Grand Harbour.
Francesco Lapparelli, who was an assistant of Michelangelo.
From the boat you get a really good view of the siege bell dedicated to the victims of the 1940-43 blockade of Malta. But it also brings home the sheer scale of the fortifications that have been put in place over the centuries, and why, with such a deep harbour, little affected by tides, it's still an incredibly important place in the Mediterranean. The commentary is pointing out Fort Sant'Angelo on our left, and on our right are the Upper Baracca Gardens, which provide a panoramic view of the three cities, and we'll see those later. Not only is the harbour a favourite stopping off place for cruise liners, it's also favoured by the very rich. As we head into one of the three cities, Vittoriosa, you get a very clear understanding of the number and value of the motor yachts that are moored here, as allegedly Malta has some of the lowest mooring fees in the Mediterranean. All things are relative, I guess. Beautiful as the day had been, as we turned slowly to head back towards Sleema, we suddenly realised that the wind was getting up, and the journey was a little bit more lively on the return. The Upper Baracca Gardens in the evening as sun was setting provided a superb panorama of the three cities. These existed long before the knights arrived on the island and made Valletta their capital. Conspicua, Sengela and Vittoriosa in front of you have been settlements since humans first lived on the island. The history of Mdina traces back more than 4,000 years. The fortress you can see here was built on a plateau and provided an ideal place to defend, as the knights found in 1565, when the Ottomans held Malta to a siege. 2,000 knights and 4,000 Maltese troops held and then repelled 40,000 of the Sultan's army. At first sight, St. Paul's Cathedral doesn't look that imposing. It was commissioned in 1697 after the previous building was destroyed in an earthquake. However, apart from the church, it has a museum full of fabulous works of art and other artifacts. Many of the houses are still occupied as homes, and the streets were absolutely pristine despite the number of tourists. But it was the view from the battlements that just served to emphasise the strategic position of the city. It was now time for us to get back to Valletta, hopefully in time for the firing of the noonday gun. The origins of the saluting battery date back to 1565, when the Ottomans were pounding the Knights of St. John in Fort St. Angelo. It was the British in the 1800s who reinstated the tradition of firing the gun, although now they use 32-pound replicas, not the original. One of the most important buildings still in Valletta is the Grand Master's Palace. This was started in 1571 and was extensively remodelled in the 1750s. It remained the residence of the Grand Master of the Order until 1798, when it became the home of the Parliament, and it's still the official residence of the President. You could be forgiven for thinking the building is a little plain on the outside, but once you get inside, the interior is really sumptuous. This is the throne room. The tapestries depict scenes from the Great Siege, and it's used often on state occasions. This is the long armoury corridor, though the armoury itself is now well below this level on the ground floor, in what used to be two stables. The collection was amassed by the knights. When one of them died, his armour and weapons were given to the order. Even in its reduced state, it's still reckoned to be one of, if not the, best collections in Europe. At one stage, it contained more than 25,000 weapons and pieces of armour. The following morning, on yet another beautiful day, gave us the opportunity to cross the Grand Harbour. It would be hard to overstate the importance of Fort St. Angelo to the Maltese. The present fort is the sum of additions and improvements made over centuries, if not millennia. Its name is alleged to have derived from that of a chapel, named after the Archangel Michael, following the Norman conquest in 1091. In the 16th century, it played a key role in the Great Siege of 1565, principally because of its strategic position and the ability to direct cannon fire on the Ottoman hordes endeavouring to enter the harbour. On arrival, we were fortunate enough to be invited by two Canadians to join their private tour of the Castellan's apartments.
The Castellan, it was mentioned that they had total jurisdiction on the side until the ditch. From the ditch outwards was one of the jurisdictions of the capital of Malta, who would then reside in the capital city in Mdina.
Moving along the terraces past the Castellan's Chapel showed us just what a superb view the gunners at the fort must have had. No surprise then that the Royal Navy upgraded the armaments in 1906 when they moved their Mediterranean headquarters here, and here it remained until well after both world wars. By now it was nearly lunchtime, so watch out for the noonday gun. Also in Virtuoso, not far from the fort, is the Inquisitor's Palace. Interesting, but gruesome. Much more interesting was the Malta at War Museum. It combines a modern multi-sensory museum at ground level with a breathtaking visit, literally, to the vast underground wartime air raid shelters. The suffering of the Maltese people during World War II particularly is very well described, and the extent of the damage is graphically shown, reinforcing that which we'd already had at Fort Sant'Angelo. This plan shows the extent of the tunnels, and at this point, hard hats were being handed out. That's why we needed the hats. As we travel back down Vittorioso Harbour, it's hard not to reflect on the actions that have taken place here, and how short our own lifespan is compared to the centuries of change that have impacted on the Grand Harbour as a whole. Tomorrow, as they say, is another day, and there's more to learn. So first thing, it's back to the Upper Baracca Gardens, and then into the tunnels under the saluting battery. First of all, we were allowed out onto the battery itself for a close-up look at the guns, before descending into the cliff face underneath. Thank you. We won't be going to the Lascaris war rooms, used in World War II, but we will be seeing some of the older tunnels dug out back in the day of the Knights.
Radio filter rooms. Now, radio filter rooms, they would listen to all of the air traffic, would be the German air traffic, the Italian, our own air traffic, and then the people over there, they would take the extract the relevant information and send them to the relevant people.
Right, the officer.
Now, I will go over here. Highest command.
Our guide also took us into the old powder room, where the shot had been stored for the cannons. But being out on the terrace certainly brought home the scale of the defences and the conditions in which its occupants would have to have lived for extended periods. Hobnail boots would certainly not have been worn. That afternoon we returned once again to the Three Cities, this time to take a more extended tour by land train. The first part of the journey took us through Vittoriosa, past the Inquisitor's Palace and the War Museum.
In the Second World War, this museum was used as a police station, and underneath lies what used to be an NRA shelter. In this shelter, one can experience the suffering of the day-to-day problems that the Maltese faced in the Second World War. We are now in the village of Calcara. Historians believe that when the first people came to Malta, it was around 7,000 years ago, it was the first place to be inhabited since it served as an adequate shelter from the heavy storms.
Setting aside the impatience of Maltese drivers, you get another lovely view of Fort Sant'Angelo from Calcara Harbour.
We can appreciate the fortifications surrounding Vittoriosa. This is a very old city dating back to the medieval times. The small sandy beach is the only one in the Grand Harbor. In front of us, we can see Fort Ricasoli.
A final whiz round the streets of Conspicua brought not only the tour, but also our stay in Valletta to an end. So until next time, adieu.